Ladies and gentlemen, welcome back. It is my distinct pleasure today to bring you a look at Stardew Valley. So this is probably the most unlikely game of 2016, or I would say the most unlikely game of the last, 10 years or so. Basically, it's Harvest Moon reimagined with some nice little features and tweaks to it and all kinds of great things to do. So, as you've no doubt noticed at this point, the game is about farming. It is a farming simulator. You go and you plant crops and you sell them and you run around and collect stuff and just have a generally grand time. So it also includes some animal husbandry bits and pieces. In this case, let's go see what the chickens left. Alright, got some eggs. So as mentioned, Stardew Valley is a pretty unlikely game. So it was developed by one guy. This guy's name, he goes by Concerned Ape. And basically he started out as just wanting to learn how to program in C#. And what grew out of that is this particular game. And it's just absolutely fantastic. So it comes as quite a contrast to most of your more modern games that involve you shooting everything in sight, you know, blowing everything up, and generally having a great time doing it. Oops, missed a cow. And in that contrast, there's some kind of, bit and piece that has been captured by this game that just hasn't been seen in the gaming world for quite a while. So as I write this, it is still one of the most popular titles on Steam by not a small margin, by a fairly large margin. And, right now it's right up there alongside Tom Clancy's The Division, which released somewhat to the extent of, released after this game came out. But anyhow, taking a look at the game and the mechanics, they're all fairly simple. You plant crops, you have different types, you water said crops. In this case, I use sprinklers to do it. I'm sitting here in spring of year two. You have animals that you collect produce from, and you have a fairly large area to run around in. Now, when you first start out the game, everything will be covered in just this kind of mess in through here. It's important to clear that out, and some of it comes back the next spring, including all the nice grass and such that make your cows and chickens all kinds of happy. The area is broken up into your fairly typical bits and pieces. So you've got some woods to run around, some lakes to fish in, some streams and rivers to fish in, etc. A train station, a spa to go visit, some mines to play around in. Haven't unlocked that yet. That's probably coming at some point. But yeah, all in all, it is just an extremely enjoyable experience, and I think that's part of the reason why it's captured the hearts and minds of so many individuals. Earlier this week, this was the most watched game on Twitch, which is quite saying something. I mean, especially given the price of this game is a total of about $15, so there's really a very, very low bar to entry. Now, as far as the game's longer-term elements, because let's face it, planting stuff all the time can be a little bit boring and can probably get a bit old. The whole game is tied together with this little community center that you have up here in Pelican Town. Now, this community center, as you can see, is a little bit banged up, so it needs a good deal of love. And you have these funky-looking little dudes that sit around and they put these plaques down for you. What these plaques do is these plaques give you collections. So, for example, to complete this collection, you need to get yourself a walleye, a bream, and an eel by fishing them up. Each room follows a different suit. As you can see, there are a couple of rooms that look like they're fairly well repaired. In this case, the boiler room has been repaired. That's simply because I've completed the collection that is required to repair the room. Now, I don't quite know yet what happens when you repair everything, but I would suspect it has a change in gameplay or some other fun thing. One interesting thing about this game is that in its vintage, back in the day, there were a lot of secrets. There were a lot of hidden areas in games, and there's a lot of stuff that took a rather large amount of time to unlock. And this game follows that tradition. So at the moment, I want to say, I've got 20 hours, maybe 25 hours in on this particular character. And, I've still not gotten anywhere and everywhere. Now, this is the little town we're running through. It has all the amenities that one might expect from a farming game. So, you've got a sewer that you can go swim around in when you get a hold of the key, which I haven't figured that out yet. You got a collection of houses, your quintessential graveyard, areas you can't run through, along with shops, etc. And there are a bunch of inhabitants for this town, like we have this gal here, Haley. Right-click on them, and they talk to you. It's all fairly, vintage, for lack of a better way of putting it. So there's not a tremendous amount of character development, although there are some nice and decent character cutscenes here and there. But really, the game just has a very, very vintage feel to it. Now, something that could be really said here for the fact that this game doesn't rely on amazing graphics, doesn't rely on, you know, brand new, never-before-seen gameplay mechanics, or, you know, any kind of notable gimmick. It just simply relies on being a very solid game that lets you interact and more or less be peaceful. Now, there is an exception to that whole peaceful thing, and we'll head over there in just a second. It's going to be the mines. And the mines let you go and get other resources that you then use to craft things that are probably going to be important to you, such as these cheese presses I've got sitting here, the mayonnaise machines that were sitting over by the chicken coop. Let's go ahead and throw all this stuff in the box, or in its respective boxes, grab our junk and head off to the mines. All right. Go through the tools over here in the toolbox. And all we need is a pick and a sword. And the rest of the stuff we'll go ahead and we'll sell. Now, speaking of unlocks, as a result of completing one of those packages within the community center, it unlocked not only a bus that goes to a different area entirely, but it also unlocked these cool little mine carts that save you a lot of time in running around the map. So, boom, we're at the mines. And let's see here. So the mines are broken up into three different strata, per se. We'll just take a brief look at them. So for the first few levels, in this case level 10, it looks like, I don't know, you're more or less typical mine, so to speak. Yeah, nothing too special about it. Just a lot of dirt, some shrubbery around. It doesn't look like there's anything. There's a slime sitting over there. Let's go take him out. And yeah, okay, got slowed. All right, it's all very, very, I don't know, simplistic. It's very classical. Ooh, bugs. And if you notice, they're not hitting me for any kind of damage. That's partially because I've gotten to the bottom of the mines wearing some really great boots. All right, so let's head back up here, and let's go down to, say, level 40 and have a look down there. So level 40 starts you out in these cool little caves of ice, which are a little bit different. So the enemies are the same, although they're recolored. However, the irons and the ores that you get are one level more difficult. So let's go ahead and bust this guy, and we get some iron. Now, it's important to note that you don't start out with the mines automatically explored. Instead, you must explore the mines by going through them, taking out the bad guys, banging on rocks when necessary to present something like this guy here, which is a ladder that takes us down. Once every five levels, you'll find yourself running across an elevator. And then once you have completed those five levels, then the game effectively saves the point at which you're at, so you can continue to the nearest five to where you left off. Let's drop way down into the bowels of it here. And on this area, you'll notice that it looks a lot more, I don't know, undergroundy, if that's even a word. It almost looks like you could be conceivably under a volcano. You also notice the enemies have gotten significantly more tough. But that's kind of, you know, all part of it. Alright, moving rocks. Gotta love those guys. And things also hit a lot harder down here. Yeah, the mines are a great place to go to just gather materials, take folks out. Yeah, just generally have yourself a decent time. Now, it is important to note that the materials you get from the mines are necessary in the various crafting recipes. Alright, so let's head back out of here, and alright, it's almost time for the blacksmith to close. So let's see if we can make it there before Nope, he is now probably closed. Yep. Alright, we'll roll back over to the farm here, and we'll sleep for the night. Let's head back over to the bus stop. Now, along the lines of having a mine, once you get to the bottom of the mine, there's really not much left in the way of challenge in the mine. And, you know, everybody's looking for a challenge in a game. It's what makes a game interesting. You know, the challenge in this one is basically presented as, you know, you want to get better things. Like, for example, I absolutely feel that I need more cows. Therefore, the game is going to give me a way to do that by planting crops, selling said crops, and making some money off of it. And just like the Harvest Moons and other games of similar genre, everything's broken up into a day. And then after that day, you come back to your house and you can pop back in bed. We'll grab our pale ales here. Now, when you grow crops and when you find things around, you notice that some of the items in my inventory have a gold star. Basically, they come out as a normal item with no star beside it. Such as, for example, this golden pumpkin that, yeah, I probably should sell that guy and get some money out of it. Then you have silver quality, then you have gold quality. I tend to hold on to the gold quality items just because they can be used as gifts. There's a particular collection that requires you to have a certain number of those items sitting around. Then every night that you sleep, it gives you a tally of how much money you made off the stuff that you sold. In this case, 1,400 gold. Not great, but then again, not terrible. All right, so now the 6th of spring, and it sounds like it's raining outside. Let's go check the TV and see what tomorrow's weather will be. Nice and sunny tomorrow. All right, we'll look at the fortune teller, which the fortune teller in this case just gives you an idea of where the random number generator is going to put you as far as luck is concerned. So the spirits are neutral, means things will be about even, which should be fine. All right, so here we are again, and it looks like we've got some harvesting to do. All right, pull these guys up. One note about crops is that they all grow at different speeds. They all have different values. Generally, I'll just plant whatever it is that I believe that I need to plant and just go on from there. Really, there's nothing that sells poorly. I mean, obviously you can min-max it, but really, it's a farming game. There's really no, in my case, I don't see a point to you running through and planting the crops that always will grow you the most money in your crop. Just plant more of them. Especially, you know, once you've got yourself some sprinklers, at which point you don't have to run around actually watering your crops. Now, know that they are very resource intensive, and it is going to take you a while to actually get those. But in my opinion, it's completely worth it. A bunch of garlic here, too. Alright, this should make for a fairly nice payday. Now you notice these little thingies hanging out around. Scarecrows. So there are, in fact, crows in the game that if you don't have a scarecrow, they'll come by and they'll eat your produce and then you'll be one very sad farmer. Because then you'll have nothing to sell to anyone. And this just kind of, I don't know, makes things very unfortunate for you. Now in order to replace these items, we're going to run off to the shop here and we're going to grab some more seeds. Oop. Alright, sorry about that. We're going to run off to the shop here and grab some more seeds. So what, we had 48... what are those guys? Parsnips. Of course, a little early in the morning, the shops open up at 9 o'clock, so let's head to the community center and turn in some of these gold parsnips. I recall that there is a quality crops bundle in here. It requires... Basically, you have to get hold of five gold items or five gold crops from the three seasons in which you can grow things. So let's see here. Let's go ahead and throw parsnips in. The last summer, I managed to get a hold of corn, and then this summer, I'll go ahead and grow myself a whole bunch of melons. Now, some folks, I would suspect, out there have just kind of, I don't know, written themselves guides for how to get through these packages the fastest. And really, it kind of comes down to, in my opinion, just playing the game. You know, just play it, just enjoy it. That's what it's here for. All right, looking for someone to bring 35 copper ores. All right, cool. We'll go ahead and take that quest. And then I have 2 days to deliver 35 copper ores to him. All right, so we'll wait for Pierre's here to open up. It'll open up in 20 minutes on the game clock, which isn't too long. And then we'll go in and we need to buy a lot of seeds from him. Do, do, do. All right. Okay, so... Oh, here we go. All right, so let's see here. We got, what, 16, 36. Looks like 41 there. Yeah, we'll just buy a whole bunch of them. Parsnip seeds. You can hold down shift and you can buy fives instead of clicking like a mad rabid thing. So there's, and then I gave five of them away, so we have, oop, one too many. Oh well, we'll throw them in a box. And then garlic-wise, almost looks like 39. So we'll go ahead and buy 40 more garlic here. And then let's buy some kale as well, as kale tends to pay out well, and for a crop coming up, we'll just go with those. In some regards, some folks would feel that it's a good idea to plan everything out. I generally just kind of throw stuff down and see what sticks. granted, not the strategy for everyone, but for me, it's what makes the game enjoyable. And that's another nice feature of this genre in specific, is that this game is all about enjoyment. You know, if you want to be some ragtag farmer that goes around just slinging seeds all over the place, go for it. There is no real downside to doing it. You know, you just may not get the most optimal yield, but really, there's so much to do in the game that the getting said optimal yield is probably not the best way to use your time. Unless, of course, you happen to like hate the fishing minigame or, you know, something along those lines. And we'll get these cropped out here, and we'll see if we can head off to the desert and take a look at the other side of mining and maybe some fishing while we're out there. That sounds like a good idea. All right, so there's one short, so we'll just, I don't know, sling some kale in there. Perfect. All right, now we'll just get some more garlic down. Now, truth be told, I had planned all this out and, you know, worked out what was going to be in each area, and then I bought a bunch of seeds and just started throwing them everywhere. So that's kind of why the crops are more or less non-homogeneous. So there's kind of something a little bit of everywhere around. And then what I don't use, I'll store, and then I'll use when the next crop comes ready to harvest. All right, there we go. All right, so all of our little squares are planted. Run up here to the box that I put down for springtime seeds and throw those guys in it. And then we'll ship all kinds of stuff. There we go. A fresh apricot. I will go ahead and accept that quest. So I got this cave over here, and it's just something that just rather pops up. Oh, some tree sap. You have a cave sitting over here, and at one point a guy will approach you and say, "Hey, I want to set your cave up to do some special things." You can either grow mushrooms or he can set it up to attract fruit bats. I picked fruit bats, so I believe that it'll probably end up giving me one of those apricots. However, this time, obviously, it didn't. Let's see. I don't recall if I tended to the animals. Nope, I didn't. Let's grab the eggs here. Nope, don't want to eat an egg. Grab some bedding. Put that down. Go over here and grab our milk bucket. Go milk the cows. Let's get rid of this. All right, no timer on that one. All right, visit with the cows for a minute. Grab some milk. Seems to be a lot of happy cows around. Three large milks, one regular one. With the animals and the produce, the whole size thing, large egg, large milk, small milk, is all derived off of that whole star system, or I should say is an equivalent to that whole star system. And then when you make items with it, like in this case I'm slinging a large egg in here to make some mayonnaise out of it, that will turn into a jar of mayo with some gold beside it, or with a gold star beside it. I hang out of this oak resin, as I need it for something coming up. Alright, let's go see if we can take the bus out of the desert. Oop, forgot the fishing pole. Now it's important to note that the desert we're headed to at the moment is not something that's initially unlocked. Basically, you gotta figure out how to unlock it. And, you know, pro tip, the game tells you right there on the UI that you're going to unlock it by rolling forward with those packages that are turned to the community center. And then the gal with the wild hair would jump on the bus and drive us out to the desert. Where it is not raining. There we go. Alright, so as far as the fishing minigame is concerned, this is probably one of the things that most folks will see the first time they jump onto Reddit and check out the game. A lot of folks get very, very frustrated with this fishing minigame, and I don't quite understand why. I mean, obviously you're going to catch some junk like the green algae that I just pulled in. But there's also a considerable number of fish in the game to catch, and those fish can be used for things like making yourself fertilizer or, I don't know, eating. You can give them to people if you really don't want them to like you very much, as none of them seem to like the fish that they give you. Alright, so basically the goal is to keep the little green bar beside the fish icon. And if you manage to mess it up, then that's what happens. Your fish gets away and you get to throw it again. Now my character's fishing has been leveled up a ways. We'll take a look at that in a second. It's been leveled up ways, so the green bar that I have is much larger than it would be ordinarily. or much would be much larger than what it was when the game started out. Alright, cool. Got ourselves a sandfish. That's basically the way that fishing goes on, is it's just one of those repeat things. Going here to the worser of the mines. Now, this mine, there's a lot of fortune to be had. This mine works the same way that the other one did. The areas are full of bad guys. Or I should say there are bad guys that are present. Like this big slime sitting over here. So once we take him out, he will break up into smaller slimes. Which then need to be taken out individually. And one of them was hiding the way down. Easiest way to get rid of slimes, back him into a corner, and beat on him. Now, with some of these maps, there are train tracks, and these train tracks will lead you to a car full of coal, which is a good idea to grab, as getting a hold of coal otherwise can be kind of problematic, to such an extent that there's actually a doodad, an item implement that you can make at your farm, which will allow you to turn wood into coal. It's not very efficient, but wood is a very renewable resource, and coal requires you to go bang around in mines. Now, the important thing to note with this particular mine is that there is no elevator. So when you go down, you've just simply gone down into the mines. So there's probably a play style that comes in with the whole thing as far as how best to find your way down. As the way down can be either underneath a rock, or it can be underneath a bad guy. In my experience, generally it's going to be underneath the bad guy as opposed to underneath the rock. And granted, I've not been down very deep at all in this place, as everything in here hits very, very hard, and I haven't spent a bunch of money on my gear, which pretty much is going to be boots and sword and such. So we'll go ahead and roll out of here. And let's see. Look at that. We got a geode. This is an extremely nuanced game in some respects. There's just a lot to do. You know, there's always something to do. If it's a rainy day, it doesn't matter. There's still just tons of stuff to run around and play with. And, you know, it seems as though one of the fears that I had initially getting into the game is that when I hit the bottom of the mines, that nothing good will come of it. That'll pretty much be the end of it. It'll be kind of, you know, grindy, go back in there, mess around to get stuff that you need, and then just kind of run away and do something else. And then after getting to the bottom of the mines, I discovered that, well, hey, there's actually another mine out there. So pretty nifty all around, and a good foresight on the part of the developer. All right, let's grab our other products here. We'll sleep for the night, go take care of a couple of those geodes that we got a hold of. And while the game is repetitive, as most older design and farming games are, it's really, I don't know, it feels almost non-burdensome in its repetition. I don't know if that makes any kind of sense. But it doesn't really feel like things are much of a chore. You know, there are no tasks that are so tremendous that it's going to take you, you know, a lot of time to do them or a lot of time to handle them. Let's go ahead and throw some more hops in here. Get some more pale ale going. Grab the jellies. And why don't we ship these before we go to sleep? Now, as one can extrapolate from the farming game thing, there are abilities to upgrade your tools. For example, I have a steel pickaxe. Now, what this upgrading does is, first off, it requires quite a bit of materials. The second thing that it does for you is it lets you use your implement more efficiently. That was a nice day, about 7 grand. Let's use your implements more efficiently. And that just simply helps you out, as you have an energy bar in the bottom right-hand corner that if you happen to run that energy bar down to nothing, then you're kind of in a bad way. You can pass out and then, you know, somebody will pick you up and bring you back home. And yeah, just not a great way to go. All right, so let's take care of our chickens here. We'll go ahead and say hi to them. And look, we got some maple syrup. I think we'll take that to the community center today. I got some more eggs. Traku looks really happy today. Everybody wants a happy chicken. I wonder if you can tell if a chicken's happy or not. I don't happen to be one of those that grew up on a farm, so... really, I would suppose no telling from my perspective. Oop, didn't grab the bucket. As far as the inventory is concerned, the inventory you start with is about 11 spaces in size, and then it grows from there. You have to buy the upgrades. In this case, I just haven't bought the next upgrade. As I was devoting most of my resources towards being able to do things like have cows and buy barns and just generally enjoy myself. Alright, we seem to have a cow. Ah, there we go. Alright, 4 large milks today. I know that it's not necessary to throw all your produce into these things. It does help you increase the amount of money that you get from the produce, but ultimately it's not necessary. You can just simply sell it as is. The beehives got me some honey today. Let's see. Oh, good. Garlic that we didn't get yesterday has fully matured over the course of the evening. Let's go back and grab one garlic seed here. There we go. Drop off our bucket. Alright. Throw down a new seed. Oh, look, I missed one. Oh well. Grab that last garlic seed, and let's head out to the community center and complete a package. The other thing that this game has going for it in terms of just gameplay and the manner in which the player plays it, it's almost got like the just one more day mentality to it. Like, for example, you get done with one day and you're just like, you know what, I'm just going to play one more day, just one more. By the time you're done, it's 6 hours past your bedtime, you're tired, you're like, well, you know, that was just kind of a mess. But you never really feel like you've, I don't know, sold yourself too terribly short. All right, not that one. Maybe it's down here under the foraging bundles. All righty. Throw in some maple syrup and throw in the oak resin. There we go. The bundle is complete, so the reward is bridge repair. We'll go ahead and grab my reward, Autumn's Bounty. All right, we'll just go ahead and hang on to that. And boom, room is restored. Honestly, I can't wait to see what happens when we get all of those together. You know, what gameplay changes may come about as a result of it. The whole concept of rejuvenation as opposed to blowing everything up. Alright, 3 of 6 major bundles complete. And I didn't bother to grab the geodes to take down to the blacksmith. Which is fine, that'll only take a second here. Get this other garlic seed stuck in the ground when we get back. So I would say if you're a fan of this genre, you know, if you're like myself, you're a somewhat older gamer than what most would admit to freely, and this was a game that, you know, you kind of grew up on, or a game that was very important to you back in the day, or a type of game that was important to you back in the day, I would say that it is absolutely worth picking this up, and if nothing else, giving it a try. As I mentioned earlier, it's selling for, I think it's $14.99, so $15 US on Steam. And really, it has been well worth the time. The way that I generally tend to look at these games is that if I get, like, let's say, twice as many hours as dollars that I put into it, I'm an extremely happy camper. And in this case, so far, I've already crossed that point quite quickly, as a matter of fact, with this game. All right, so we have magma geodes, which come from the bottom of the mines, one frozen one, which comes from the middle of the mines, and then an omni geode, which the omni geodes are... The Omnigeos can contain just about anything, regardless of which era of the mine it might have come from. So we go to the town here, which will put us right outside the blacksmith's place. Let's go visit him. Alright, so let's process geodes and let's bust them open. Cost you a couple bucks, mean, you can either hang on to whatever it is that you find in them, like, for example, gold ore there, or you can just simply sell it like shiny thing here. Bust open this Omnigeode. One iron ore. All right, let's see here. Okay, so for anything that you might not have seen before in the game, this is a great time to point it out. For anything that you might not have seen in the game, there's also a museum where you can donate items, which then permits a description on the bottom of them. So the guy that runs the place is a guy called Gunther. Gunther can tell you more about this if you donate it to the museum. Why not, Gunther? So now any of those that I find in the future will have a description underneath them. Now, it remains to be seen, at least in my case, if those things are just there for, I don't know, to make money off of, or because they're pretty, or because you should be able to get cool stuff when going down to the mines, or if they have uses in later crafting. Let's take a look at the leveling here for a second. So, you have your basic skills, farming, mining, forging, fishing, and combat, that you all level up by using them and doing them. At level 5, you get to pick a particular proclivity. In this case, I picked rancher, so animal products are worth 10% more. Pick geologist, chance for gems to appear in pairs instead of all by themselves. So on and so forth. When you get up to level 10, you also get to pick another specialization. In this case, I can befriend barn animals quicker and sheep produce wool faster. Now it's important to note that even though I've got some cows and chickens, I'm nowhere near capping out the level of productivity that can be had through raising and having animals. So, in fact, you can get yourself chickens, which is all good and fine, but you can also get ducks, which lay you duck eggs. You can also get goats. They give you goat milk and goat cheese. Let's see. What else can you grab? You can also grab sheep, obviously, and they give you some wool, and that wool can be used for... You can shear it off, spin it into fabric, so on and so forth. And yeah, there's just pretty much an infinite variety of stuff in this game to do. But if you get in and you're like me and you're like, okay, well, this crop growing thing and having to water them is kind of lame. I built some sprinklers to do it for me. And so far, so good. They do a great job. We'll see if the whole thing pays for itself. But yeah, really, even if it doesn't, I'm not going to be too awfully heartbroken about it. And I think that's where we'll wrap up. As far as this game and a purchasing recommendation is concerned, once again, if this is a genre that interests you, or even if the game and the little bit of gameplay that you've seen here is something that you find compelling or that you find interesting, I would absolutely go buy the thing and give it a try. I mean, if for no other reason than just the sake of history, so to speak, and the fact that, you know, this is a fine example of what used to be pretty much a staple genre for the consoles way back in the day, were these expansive games where it's not so much contention-based. There's not much contention going on, you know, unless you get angry about pulling driftwood out of a pond. There's not a lot of contention going on. There's no real huge overarching challenge that you have to complete. You know, there's pretty much no antagonist. There's nothing but a protagonist, which is altogether kind of a refreshing change from the way that things have been going over the last number of years. Oh, went the wrong way with that. Yeah, we'll throw this in the recycler while we're over here. So these guys back here are furnaces used to smelt bars. And then I've got a recycler, which takes fishing junk and turns it into something vaguely useful. Generally, in this case, I threw a stick in there. It'll come out as a lump of charcoal, which is cool. I have two items here, which allow me to throw wood into them and get coal back out of them. So there's pretty much an innumerable number of gadgets that you can build. They're unlocked by your levels going up within farming or fishing or, you know, whatever the case may be. And then you just simply get the recipes. Like with fishing, I can make myself a worm bin. It gives me worms, which then give me bait that I can throw on my hook to do great things with. I can make a slime egg press that smashes 100 pieces of slime into a slime egg. I'm not sure what they're used for, but I don't know. It could be cool. It could just be kind of awful. Who knows? Anyhow, my name's been Jack Alatesh, and thank you for watching this video. And if you happen to try the game out, or, you know, if I missed anything great in going through and taking a look at it, please let me know in the comments section below. I look forward to seeing you soon. Thanks.